Okay, so I'm very pleased to be here. What I thought I would do, so you see the title, From Impulsivity to Compulsivity in Addiction, Neurobehavioural Substrates. I think this will be a game of two halves, and we will begin by talking about mainly impulsivity, and then we'll have coffee, and after coffee we'll talk about compulsivity. Okay? Now, I've provided two references. I'm not sure whether you got them in the end, but there is a review by myself coming in. I think it's now published with Everett in the Annual Review of Psychology, which covers most of the material of this lecture. And there's also a shorter paper in Science with Karen Ursher that discussed some of our human evidence, which was advanced reading. But I'm very happy for people to interrupt me with questions at any point, okay? So, let me say a few general things. So I suppose, just focusing on the title, I want to get across the fact that addiction is a chronic process. It takes time. It's, you know, how animals really respond to repeated self-administration of drugs over a long period and all of the neuroadaptations that that entails. I think this is a very important point to realise. Essentially, there are stages. We think there's a prodrome. You can predict risk vulnerability for certain forms of addiction. And I think there are stages from drug use to substance use disorder. And we're going to discuss some of those. So those are my disclosures for what they're worth. And I'm going to begin right away by probably reminding you of evidence which you've already heard, that I think the study of addiction in psychiatry has greatly benefited from a plausible animal model. I think when one compares other areas of psychiatry, this is less true. But in addiction, you have the self-administration model, where rodents and monkeys will self-administer drug directly into the vein via catheter. Self-administration, I think, is a very important component of studying addiction, because the effect of an experimenter-administered drug is very different from a self-administered drug. And I think this has to be realised from the outset. On the other hand, self-administration itself is not addiction. Self-administration is merely showing the positive reinforcing effect of a drug, just like food. It is not addiction in itself. Addiction is a chronic process. In terms of brain mechanisms, there are lots of pioneers in this area, Roy Wise being one. But I'd like to focus a little bit on Bartley Herbel at Yale, who died 2 or 3 years ago. And he managed to devise a procedure for getting rats to self-administer amphetamine, not into the vein, but into the brain directly. And other people have tried this as well, but he was, I think, the first to publish in 1983 evidence that rats would self-administer amphetamine unilaterally into one side of the nucleus accumbens. So these experiments are technically very clever. They're very small volumes, nanoliters of drug, and the amount of drug that could be self-administered was fixed. It was capped at quite a low level. And it's possible to show that rats would respond on one lever to get the drug and not respond on the other lever. This was the evidence. This choice procedure is evidence that the animals were self-administering the drug directly into the nucleus accumbens. And it's interesting, you know, other investigators, including Wise and Godet, have studied where amphetamine might be administered in the brain, and the only other place really has been shown to be the VTA. So this is some of the first evidence, which followed on from evidence of brain stimulation reward, that the dopamine system probably was implicated in reward, if you like. Amphetamine being, of course, a potent dopamine releaser. The experiment we did with Gavin Phillips in the 90s was to replicate this study bilaterally in the accumbens, but we also infused dopamine receptor blockers at the same time and showed that under those conditions, the rats would regulate the self-administration of amphetamine. So in other words, taking a leaf out of what Roy Wise had discovered earlier with systemic peripheral administration, if you give a dopamine receptor blocker, animals will self-administer more drug. Even though these drugs have motor effects to reduce behavior, they would self-administer more, presumably because in some possibly even homeostatic sense, they are regulating the optimal level of dopamine release in the accumbens. And that's what this experiment showed about. So, of course, there's lots of other evidence showing that dopamine depletion in the accumbens reduces self-administration of cocaine. Work earlier in the 70s by Phillips, Fibiger and Roberts. So that's some of the background, I think, to this story. Let's get rid of this. Okay, well, what we've been talking about so far with self-administration is an example of classical learning theory. And I'm sure you've heard all this before, but maybe it's worth just going over a few points. So it's an example, of course, of positive reinforcement or instrumental conditioning, which in the modern parlance is called action-outcome learning. So an action is a lever press, an outcome is an infusion of drug or food, for example. And you could call this seeking behavior as well as taking behavior, because the response could also lead not only to a drug, but also to a drug-paired cue, a cue which predicts the drug and would almost certainly be associated with phasic firing of dopamine cells as a conditioned stimulus. Because, of course, in the real world, not everything you do produces a drug. Behaviour is very complicated. To get a drug, an addict may have to search widely for it and use predictive cues, maybe even people, to predict where they're going to get their next hit. So to really model drug-seeking behaviour, you have to invoke conditioning to other cues, which, as we know, gain incredible properties. Some of the descriptions of speed freaks in San Francisco, when they even see a syringe, they can get high on it. So some of the affective consequence of the drug can be translated to stimuli which predict the drug, okay? And are important in motivating the stream of behavior that occurs before the drug is acquired. So we call this behavior voluntary control of the environment, and it's goal-directed initially. And the phenomena are drug use and abuse. Now, another hypothesis is that there's a similar learning process occurring which doesn't encode the reinforcer or the outcome as part of the association. It simply links stimulus to response. It needs the reinforcer to make that connection, but the outcome isn't part of the association that's represented. And this is called a habit. So a habit is when you automatically do a response when a stimulus is present. Okay? So a stimulus occurs, you do a response. This is a very efficient form of learning. It's very quick, it's very automatic, it's evolutionarily very adaptive. It occurs after large amounts of pairings of stimulus and response. And it may be linked to what we call procedural learning or skill learning. And I'm going to argue that some of this behavior is incorporated into compulsive behavior, which is part of addiction. Okay, so our early attempts to understand the neural network underlying drug abuse and addiction, basically used behavioural neuroscience studies in rats and monkeys, with some studies from humans using neuroimaging very early on. And this is something I'll come back to subsequently, but it does highlight, I think, some of the main players in the networks, which you've probably already heard about. So clearly some of the main players are in the stratum, the ventral stratum, and remember that the accumbens in the ventral stratum has at least two components. It has a shell region and a core region. I don't know whether you've heard about these before, but these turn out to be very importantly different and have probably different roles in addiction. There's also the dorsal stratum, of course, associated with the caudate putamen and Parkinson's disease and originally motor functions. And these regions of stratum are potently innervated by the ascending dopamine systems, of course, and the VTA and the Nigra. There's another component here, which I'm not going to talk very much about. This is a favourite of George Kube as part of the extended amygdala, which includes the central nucleus of the amygdala and the bed nucleus of the stria terminalis, which seem to have very important roles in negative emotional states associated with dysphoria, for example, after opiate withdrawal or even cocaine withdrawal. Okay, some of the main inputs to this all-important striatal region come from the amygdala, from the basolateral amygdala, also the hippocampus and the prefrontal cortex. We're going to focus on those. Prefrontal cortex, I'll talk more about later in the talk, but clearly has some overall role in controlling output from the stratum. I think this is a very important consideration. Hippocampus is very much involved in contextual conditioning. Context conditioning is everything else apart from discrete cues. So it's the room rather than the blue shirt, for example. Contextual conditioning is very important in drug abuse, and so is discrete cue conditioning, which is mediated in part by the amygdala, in particular the basolateral amygdala. And I'll describe briefly some work which suggests that the amygdala is very important for providing the source of associations between stimuli and rewards, conditioned stimuli and drug rewards or food rewards. This is a very important component of the conditioning process. And it feeds this information into the stratum to produce what I'm going to call conditioned reinforcement, which, as you'll see, is an important component of drug-seeking behaviour. Okay, so going back in the ends of time, this is very much pre-Schultz, but it showed early on that this system is very much involved in conditioning, conditioned stimuli. So in these experiments, these are to do with water, actually. It could have been food as well. In these experiments, conditioned stimuli are paired in a Pavlovian manner with food or water. So they gain predictive significance and would produce prediction errors, for example. Following that pairing, so that they gain motivational significance, we test how rewarding these stimuli are in themselves by allowing the rat to respond to turn on the stimulus in the absence of the reward of the food or the water, or indeed the drug. And these stimuli do have rewarding properties. So given a choice between the two, you'll see that a normal rat will respond several times more for the conditioned stimulus. And the interesting thing is, if you put amphetamine into the accumbens to release dopamine there, you get a huge increase in the what's subsequently been called the incentive salience of the stimulus. This is what Kent Berridge calls incentive salience. So this stimulus gains in significance after amphetamine. That's interesting for a variety of reasons, because it begins to suggest perhaps why drugs can be rewarding. I mean, this is a question we really need to ask. Why is a drug rewarding? Maybe it makes the world more rewarding. It makes stimuli in the world more rewarding, so that you're more likely to work for those stimuli. Okay, and you'll notice that on the control lever, there's no real increase here. So this is a huge effect. And it depends on dopamine, because if dopamine's removed from the accumbens, although the conditioned influence is still there, the effect of amphetamine is completely blocked because it's releasing dopamine. So this multiplication is dopamine dependent. Now, the association itself is dependent on the amygdala, because if the amygdala is damaged, this basolateral area, you can see there's no real preference for the stimulus, and amphetamine has a very weak effect when infused there. So we have a two-factor theory here. The amygdala provides associative information to the accumbens, and dopamine amplifies that effect to produce this huge potentiation of incentive salience. This has to be relevant for understanding the effects of stimulant drugs, for example. But you can get similar effects with opioids as well. Now, within the accumbens, of course, there's the core and the shell, and these can be manipulated separately, and one can infuse drugs into these areas quite discreetly. An interesting result we found subsequently, quite a lot later, is that when the core is damaged, this greatly reduces the effect of the conditioned reinforcer. Not completely, as you can see, these are the controls, but the control of behaviour is greatly reduced by core lesions. Whereas the effect of amphetamine itself is greatly dependent on the shell region. So if the shell is damaged, you see this flattening of response. There's still conditioning information there, as you see in this difference, but the effect of amphetamine is lost. So these two factors, the multiplication and the discrimination by the conditioned stimulus, are mediated by two different regions of the accumbens.
So when you've got the stimulus as the sort of rewarding aspect, perhaps just for the stimulus, obviously in humans, people take drugs in a very particular context, whether you want to go out to a club or just relax in a room. Have you ever done an experiment where you've given the rat a choice between multiple stimulus and they get to choose which one they prefer, even though they get the same outcome and they have equal rewards?
Yeah, well, I mean, that kind of experiment's been done with conditioned place preference. And I'm sure you're all aware of conditioned place preference with drugs. And that's essentially contextual conditioning, except it's a very dirty procedure. And it's not really conditioned place preference, because actually probably the animals focus on rather discrete cues rather than the context. And we've shown that, which is why conditioned place preference is also sensitive to amygdala damage. But if you do conditioned place preference properly and make the animal depend on a configuration of cues, then the hippocampus is important. So that's a very interesting point. Okay, well, the reason I'm talking about this in terms of addiction is because we developed a procedure which uses this effect, this enhancement of conditioned reinforcement, to model drug-seeking behavior. So, the interesting point that the problem with studying self-administration is that as soon as the animal starts self-administering the drug, it's going to have other effects. It's going to have effects on locomotor activity, on motivation, and everything else. So how do you distinguish the effect of the drug as an incentive, as a reward in the future, from its performance-altering effects? It's very difficult to do. Originally, we studied sexual behavior. It's a similar problem. If you put a male rat with a female rat, it's very hard to study the male rat's motivation because the sex is all over in an instant. And after the male rat has copulated the female, he goes to sleep. You know, it's very hard to measure motivation then. So you have to have a procedure where the male rat works for the female for a long time before he gains access. And the way we did that was to have the rat respond for a female in a trap door compartment, which would be released after a certain amount of work had been done. So it's a bit like a progressive ratio schedule, which you've heard before, but it's different. It's different in this sense that in the first interval, and this is 15 minutes or so, every 10 responses produces a stimulus, a condition reinforcer, which predicts the female. It could be a red light. And then after you've performed 15 minutes worth of this behaviour, then the female will appear through the trapdoor. So you can measure motivation by how hard the male rat works in that period, okay, in the absence of the female. So there's a similar logic with drug. In this case, the animal gets its first infusion of cocaine only after 15 minutes of work. And during that 15 minutes, it gradually begins to respond in anticipation of the drug. And these ticks here are simply presentations of the light. See how interested in the light the rat is? He's kissing it. He loves that light. And it only occurs after each 10 responses and goes out. It's a brief light. But after a large number of these, it will get cocaine. And then once cocaine's on board, wow, you can see behaviour takes off. But this is partly because the drug is going to be activating behaviour as well. And of course, as I've already shown you, amphetamine enhances the effects of conditioned stimuli. So this is a double whammy. The drug is enhancing the effect of a conditioned stimulus which predicts it. This is why it's so compelling, if you like, for the rat. Okay. So they can work for long periods for the drug. So this is what's called a second order schedule. And it's, I think, useful for measuring drug seeking behaviour. Now, it's practically useful. We've been using it to screen new drugs which might be used in the treatment of addiction. And one such new drug is a new mu opioid receptor antagonist, which is a GSK compound we call 498 for short. And it's very interesting. You see this drug in the first interval, in a dose-dependent way, reduces drug-seeking behaviour dramatically. Once the drug's on board, it has no effect. So we think that this drug will only be useful for drug addicts who are seeking treatment and do not want to seek the drug anymore. Once they take the drug, it's hopeless because the opioid antagonist doesn't seem to block that. But it does block drug seeking. So this is just a practical use of this type of procedure. Now let's go back to the neural substrates of this behaviour and go back to the shell and the core of the accumbens. So remember that the core was very much implicated in conditioning, receiving these inputs presumably from the basolateral amygdala. So if we damage the core bilaterally, we should destroy second order behaviour. And we largely do. So these are control animals showing this beautiful succession of self-ministration. These big triangles are cocaine infusions. See, this goes on for nearly over 30 minutes. After a core lesion, actually they're shattered, really. The behaviour is fairly miserable. It's greatly reduced. Because the influence of these conditioned stimuli is greatly lost as a consequence of this damage. With the shell lesion, it's interesting. What you see is a huge difference between with controls, but the control over behaviour is there, but as you can see, there's much less enthusiasm, as it were, for the drug. So the amplification effect, the magnification that was produced by the shell for the conditioned stimulus has been lost again in this procedure. So it's similar to what I showed you before with food rewards. So the core and the shell are important. and so too is the amygdala. So again, if the amygdala is damaged, and these again are excitotoxic fibrosparing lesions, what happens here is you, if you study the acquisition of this learning, this second order behaviour, you gradually have to increase the requirement, the number of times the rat has to press the lever to get the conditioned stimulus. And as you do that, you can see that, well, it gets a bit harder for control animals, but amygdala damage really completely knocks out drug-seeking behaviour. So drug-seeking is clearly dependent on this circuit, which involves the basolateral amygdala and the core, probably in the shell of the accumbens, working together in some way. It would be very interesting to explore this with optogenetics, and in Cambridge we have got some preliminary data which support these results, although using chemicogenetics rather than optogenetics in the rat at this point. So why is this all relevant? Well, Childress and others had shown that Pavlovian conditioned stimuli have effects of drug memories in humans. A stimulus associated with the drug increases activity in the brain in those areas that retrieve the memory of the drug. And the kind of areas implicated here, these are the bold activations of the amygdala, of course, the orbital frontal cortex, and also the cingulate cortex. So drug-associated stimuli in humans clearly do involve the certainly parts of the network that we've highlighted in the rodent. Okay, so going back to this, this scheme, what I've described so far is this effect, the basolateral amygdala, affecting conditioned reinforcement, stimulant reinforcement by the drug in the shell. Somehow, this interaction leads ultimately to behavioural output, and that's obviously what we've got to consider ultimately.
So, Trevor,
yes.
In your model, obviously you cannot distinguish between the D1 and the D2. How would you, now that we can, how would you integrate this? Because you mark it within major areas of the ventral and dorsal striatum, knowing that they are the intersection of two sometimes opposingly working circuits.
I think it's a very interesting question. We know that the conditioned reinforcement effect depends on both D1 and D2 receptors. I can show you those data. Both D1 and D2 receptors are implicated within the accumbens itself for the conditioned reinforcement effect.
So for that, you wouldn't make a difference between D1 and D2?
Not for that particularly, no. I think it's rather unclear what happens with the direct and indirect pathways from the accumbens, much less so than for the dorsal stratum. The dorsal stratum, we've got some evidence of separation of D1 and D2. It's less clear to us for the accumbens. But I think this is an interesting point. And in general, my theory is that D1 receptors have to be carrying the prediction error, ultimately, because the phasic activity of the dopamine neurons is very NMDA dependent, and that links to D1 receptors. Whereas the D2 receptor is much more implicated in the tonic activity of the system. And what we've been describing here essentially are learning effects and performance effects, and maybe together they implicate both of these modes of the dopamine system. That would be a speculation, but I don't think there's very much, perhaps you can tell me, what is the evidence for the involvement of D1 and D2 receptors in prediction error?
I mean, the dopamine that is released, if the dopamine neurons are signaling prediction errors, is certainly not selectively activating D1 or D2. This is a non-selective agonist, so they're both seeing it, but probably what is very different is how the cell reacts to it.
Yeah.
In response to D1, you can get totally different forms of plasticity compared to the D2. Mm. That's clear. Literature saying that particularly the concomitant activation of D1 and NMDA receptors will potentiate excited reactions onto those neurons.
Sure.
Where this is certainly not the case with the D2, where with normal activity and dopamine activation, you rather have a depression. So propensity for LTP is a property of the D1, whereas the D2
exactly.
is the converse.
Exactly, exactly.
So, but that would suggest that you have a contrast that builds up between the D1 and the D2 in these situations.
Yeah, and I think there's acquisition and performance. Those are the two things that are going on.
Yeah.
There's the tonic, this amplification effect is clearly tonic, probably D2 related, and the learning is D1 and phasically related. Okay, well, I'm going to go to discuss what happens subsequently, we think, in this system. I'm going to come to talk about impulsivity in a moment, but basically I want to now describe what may happen with chronic self-ministration behaviours, where we think that the dorsal stratum begins to be recruited, importantly, in habit-based learning structures. And zeroing in on the networks here, I'm sure you've probably seen this diagram before as well by Suzanne Haber, this beautiful anatomy by which the shell and the core communicate with the dorsal stratum via this cascade of spiraling connections involving the dopamine neurons in the VTA and the nigra. Basically, what happens here is that the outputs from the shell project to those dopamine neurons which activate the core, and the core then successively to ventral caudate, and ventral caudate ultimately, as you see, to putamen. So this is one way by which activity in the shell region, the core region, ultimately may affect activity in more dorsal striatal areas. There are probably many other routes for this to occur, obviously involving cortical mechanisms as well. But this is a very intriguing circuitry which we think needs to be understood in much more detail.
Just one thing, in some of the previous lectures, we have also looked at that spiral, and one thing that sort of emerges is when you redo the anatomy with cellular resolution is that the primary target of the output from the ventral striatum is not the dopamine neurons, but the GABA neurons in the midbrain.
Yes.
So you think that needs to be integrated into this?
Yes, well, the GABA neurons are these descending influences here to the VTA. I think that's very important.
No, of course, the output neurons of the accumbens are GABA neurons.
Yes.
Which primarily local GABA neurons in the midbrain, which is not the way this system is built.
No. But this is basically the scheme by which it occurs, the interaction successively from the shell to the putamen. And the precise cellular details of the mechanism has to be worked out, I agree. But that's for you to do.
Yeah, I guess I would argue we have done it in part.
Yeah, okay, all right.
So that can be integrated.
Good, well that's good news. So the reason that we think the dorsal stratum is so important really comes back to this drug-seeking procedure where we're able to actually measure dopamine originally with dialysis in this system. So I'm sure you've come across in vivo microdialysis in this course so far, which is a way of actually measuring dopamine extracellularly using a dialysis probe in the brain. So it's the dopamine is then measured, quantified using standard HPLC methodologies. And it's rather complementary to in vivo voltammetry, where one measures electrochemical potentials directly. But it has a longer time course than in vivo voltammetry. And basically, this really, I think, amazing set of results we discovered in the early 2000s and has largely been replicated, I think, using the voltammetric method. Basically, during the second order schedule, dopamine is sampled in the shell region. And in that period, that initial 15-minute period, you can also measure the release of dopamine in response to the conditioned stimuli which are occurring before the drug is on board. Okay? And intriguingly, in the shell region, using this method, you don't see very much, actually, dopamine release to the CS during the seeking phase. But as soon as the next period begins, when the cocaine is self-administered, there is a huge increase in extracellular dopamine, as you see here. So the shell is not looking at the conditioned stimulus, at least the dopamine neurons aren't, but it's looking very much at the drug itself. Now, in the core region, it's interesting because in the core region, you get something rather like Wolfram Schultz has shown. Again, you get some increase of dopamine after cocaine. It's quite a big effect, but it's smaller than the shell, as you can see here. During the schedule itself, there's not much evidence of increased dopamine release. There's no real significant difference there. However, if you take the rat and put it in another environment and play the conditioned stimulus that's associated with the drug, it produces a huge increase. And we assume that this is after a lot of training, of course, and we assume that essentially we're looking here at a prediction error. When the conditioned stimulus is put in a new surprising context, you see an increase of dopamine. This is exactly what Schultz predicts. So eventually, responses to the CS go down with Schultz, even after chronic conditioning. But if you change the stimulus in any way, then it comes back, and that's what you're seeing here. The really interesting result is this one, perhaps, where we actually saw increases to the conditioned stimulus, which are almost as great as to the drug itself, during the seeking phase, before the drug's on board. It's a huge release of dopamine in the dorsal stratum, not in the ventral stratum. And this only occurs after protracted training. So this suggests to us that there is some change in the way the behaviour is controlled chronically from the ventral to the dorsal stratum. The dorsal stratum becomes progressively more important in controlling this drug-seeking behaviour. That's the message that we got from this experiment, or this set of experiments, which I think have largely been replicated using other means. Now, an experiment which kind of highlights the role of the dorsal stratum, an early one by Barry Everett and van der Schuren, shows that if you block dopamine receptors in the dorsal stratum in this first phase, the drug-seeking phase, you get a lovely reduction of responding. This is highly dose-dependent. This is in very well-trained rats. If you then infuse dopamine depletion into the accumbens, there's nothing. This is very different. You remember, the core is very important for this behaviour. And early on in conditioning, dopamine blockade would reduce responding. But in well-established responding, the dorsal stratum dopamine seems to be more important than the ventral stratal dopamine. So there's a devolution of control to the dorsal stratum. Yes.
Good question. But not exactly under these circumstances, but under other circumstances where animals are well trained in seeking drugs, you can block the seeking by putting an AMPA receptor antagonist into the core.
Yeah.
So is it just that the core's role
changes?
Is
changes.
More glutamate dependent,
yes.
Not so much.
Brilliant. It changes.
Okay. Because yes. I think people too often go with this literal view. They read this and they say, ah, core drops out. But that's
no,
not
no, the core doesn't drop out. No, the core is still involved.
It's just not the
core is still involved. And there are experiments, if you asymmetrically put if you do the experiment, the core on one side and the stratum on the other, the core is still implicated. It's still involved, but its role changes. And this clearly is indicated from this result. So this is then implicating the system in what we call habit learning, because the stratum, dorsal stratum, is very much involved in the stimulus response learning. And I'll provide some evidence for that in a moment. So we're now just looking at some of these systems. We've been showing you schema of the brain. This is the human brain. This is the human reward system, really logged in a very different manner using brain imaging methodology. But you'll see the head ganglion is the autofrontal cortex, there's the ventral stratum, the amygdala. This is one of the famous corticostriatal loops, the hot loop here, in parallel with these other loops, which have other functions, including motor functions, and as you'll see, functions we think in goal-directed behaviour and habit learning. So let's have a little look at how this plays out in humans, because after all, we're mainly interested in human addiction. And I think, you know, one of the classical demonstrations of the translation of this work, certainly with dopamine receptors, has come from Nora Volkow, who, as we know, is the head of NIDA and a relative of Trotsky. And she showed, using ligand-based PET, that drug abusers show reduced binding of D2 receptors persistently in the striatal region. So this is cocaine abusers, methamphetamine abusers, and alcoholics compared to controls. And clearly, D2 receptor availability is reduced using this ligand-based PET technique. So this is classic work. But there is a problem of interpretation. What does it really mean? What does a reduction of D2 receptors mean, actually? And again, the other issue is this caused by addiction or an effect of addiction? So what I mean is, in these individuals, did the drug abuse cause this downregulation, or were the changes there before they took drugs? Logically, both are possible. And it's impossible to work this out using human studies, because the only way to do it is to do a longitudinal study using PET ligands, and you have to begin in neonates, and that's ethically not feasible. So this is a difficult question to resolve, actually, and it pops up in a number of other examples. But one very important observation is this, that this reduction of D2 receptors is correlated with hypometabolism of the orbitofrontal cortex. So, in other words, the fewer dopamine receptors, the less active is this area, metabolically. And that's an amazing result, if you think about it, because we're talking about D2 receptors in the stratum associated with the activity of the orbitofrontal cortex. Clearly shows there's some kind of loop here, that change in dopamine function in the stratum alters the function of this loop system, right? So we'll come back to that. But it has enormous implications because, you know, the orbitofrontal cortex is a very important structure. It's very importantly involved in decision-making about rewards. The classic work of Damasio with the Iowa gambling task shows that damage to this area produces horrible effects on decision-making. Now, if you go back to drug addicts who've got hyperactive orbitofrontal cortices, presumably they will also have bad decision-making. Right? And that's not going to help their addiction. That's not going to help their addiction. They will indulge in risky behaviours.
So if you had to make a guess or a prediction, do you think that bad decision making makes you vulnerable to addiction because you're more likely to make bad decisions? Or is it the bad decision making reinforced by the drug taking?
So what I think is going on is both of these, and that's the evidence I'm going to provide you later. So there is a predisposition. It is associated with bad decision making. But once you have drugs on top of that, it makes it even worse. Yeah.
decision making has also been found in other pathological disorders like gambling.
Yes.
Yeah. Is there any relationship between that gambling?
Yes. And so the classic decision. Well, actually, let me show you my next slide. Okay, I'll show you my next slide. But before we go there, I'll just point out that in chronic methamphetamine abusers post-mortem, this area is seriously reduced in metabolites of serotonin. So this is almost certainly a consequence of chronic drug treatment. Serotonin depletion occurs in this area, and we know that that also leads to impairments in decision-making. So the kind of decision-making that we study is the gambling task, the Cambridge gambling task, where you're presented with an array of red and blue boxes which vary from 9 to 1 to 6 to 4 as you see here, and you have to guess where you think the reward is going to be hidden. Is it in a blue box or red box? What do you think, Christian? Is it a blue box or red box? Well, the rational choice is always the blue box. You would always go to the majority. That's a rational decision, right? And then you're allowed to bet a number of points on the correctness of your decision, having chosen blue. And if you're correct, you'll get those points added to your pot. And if you're incorrect, you'll become bankrupt. So patients with damage to the orbitofrontal cortex are terrible on this task. They get bankrupted very quickly. They take huge risks, and so do amphetamine abusers. And the quality of their decision making is correlated with the duration of their abuse of amphetamine. Okay? Which is interesting. Correlations, what do correlations mean? It just suggests that the longer you've been taking the drug, there may be pathological consequences in the brain, and that damages these structures which are implicated in decision making. That would be an interpretation. It's not completely watertight, but it's suggestive. Now, an important part of decision making is impulsivity, impulsive choice, going for what's easy and quick rather than better in the long term. Health-related decisions, deciding not to smoke because you'll die, those type of decisions, that's discounting. And impulsivity is defined as actions which are poorly conceived, prematurely expressed, you respond too quickly without adequate reflection, unduly risky, inappropriate to the situation, and often, but not always, result in undesirable consequences. So, of course, these are some of the conditions which are associated with impulsivity, includes more than just substance abuse, ADHD, personality disorders, and these are some of the mechanisms that we have to consider. Motor disinhibition, sensitivity to reward, and lack of reflection when making decisions, probably very frontal function. There are probably different forms of impulsivity. In fact, we are fairly sure there are. But it's certainly true that drug abusers are impulsive, however you measure it. Huge amount of evidence that stimulant abusers respond too quickly and they respond in a risky fashion. Generally, this impulsivity is quantified using a self-report questionnaire, which I'm going to show you in a moment. But there's no doubt that impulsivity is an important part of being an addict. The interesting question, however, is cause or effect? Is the impulsivity caused by drug abuse, or was it there before you were exposed to drugs? Okay? Now, this question is a bit more tractable than the PET question, but it's an interesting one. And the way that we've started to try to resolve it is capitalised on the fact that you can measure impulsivity in rodents and humans using rather parallel procedures. So some of these procedures, which I don't have time to talk about in detail, but I'm very happy to if you want me to later, include discounting. So this is where you're given a choice between the small immediate reward or the large delayed reward. One pellet now of food or four pellets in 16 seconds. Okay, you can measure this in rats as well as in humans. In humans, you say you can have $20 now or $25 in 4 days' time. What do you prefer, Christian? He wants the $20 now.
No.
Anyway, it's those are the type of choices that are involved in discounting. Stop signal reaction time task, which you probably haven't heard about yet, is a way of measuring motor impulsivity, which is impaired in ADHD, and I'll show you some data on that in a moment. And the way we've also been measuring this in rodents is with this five choice serial reaction time task, which is based on a human task, where rats are trained to detect signals which predict reward in this array of apertures. And the important point from our point of view is that they have to wait until the stimulus occurs before they respond. If they respond too soon, they don't get the reward, they're punished with darkness for a few seconds. So it's a bad idea to respond prematurely. You have to control yourself, okay? Now, we know a lot about this task. We know that the rat needs virtually the whole of its frontal cortex and striatum to perform it optimally. And simple excitotoxic lesion evidence shows that accuracy depends on the cingulate cortex. But importantly, from our point of view, impulsivity depends on this infralimbic medial prefrontal cortical area here, which projects directly into the shell region here. Compulsivity, measured in terms of perseverative responding, seems to be dependent more on orbital frontal regions, but I won't refer much to that at this point. So this is just some evidence. If you infuse an NMDA receptor antagonist into the rat infralimbic cortex, this is the kind of effect you get. It's absolutely huge. A huge increase in premature responding, which is dose dependent, and not produced by infusing the drug just above the infralimbic cortex. So this is a big effect. And the accumbens is interesting as well in this behavior, because amphetamine, infused either into the accumbens or systemically, produces huge increases in impulsive responding, which are dopamine dependent. As you see here, this is the dose response curve. If you damage the shell region, you can obliterate much of this increase, that's there. If you damage the core, you exacerbate it. So the shell and the core are opponent in controlling this output somehow. Their opponent, but the accumbens is very important for impulsivity. And one of the main circuits we think depends on this input from infralimbic cortex. Now the reason we're interested in this behavior is because it varies, this impulsivity varies a lot in a population of hooded rats. So if you take 100 hooded rats, maybe 10 of them will show this huge increase in impulsive responding, which is persistent. They don't get it out of their system. They can't help themselves. They just continue to respond prematurely. They're okay at detecting the visual events. They're not more active than normal. The phenotype is very interesting. I can discuss it in detail. But these guys just can't stop themselves responding prematurely. It breeds true. Over three or four generations, you'll get an increase in impulsivity if you breed this. We haven't published yet, but we have done a GWAS study, and this is Jeff Daly's work, and the genes that seem to be implicated in the impulsivity are GABA receptor genes, mGluR5 receptors, and a whole range of synaptic proteins, which is quite interesting, but we're still churning through this analysis. The reason it's interesting is that if you subsequently to screening them for impulsivity allow them access for the first time to cocaine in a binge access paradigm, they take a lot of cocaine. So these high impulsive rats, they don't respond more initially, actually, which is an important point, as you'll hear later. But chronically, they begin to take lots of cocaine. Some of them have to be restrained because they self-administer lethal doses. So as you can see, it's quite a big effect. And I'll come back to this in a moment. So this is interesting because it suggests that this has been used as an index of compulsive drug seeking. And they clearly are, in that sense, more compulsive as well as more impulsive. Now, we're not the only ones who've done this type of work. The Dutch group, led by Diergaard, Thomas Patti, and others, have shown similar effects with nicotine, with high impulsive rats on this paradigm, and similar effects also with sucrose, interestingly. But we have not seen such effects with heroin on this procedure. So high impulsive rats don't seem to self-administer more heroin. And alcohol is another interesting case, yeah?
Is the heroin aspect possibly a sedative effect of heroin? So even though they're impulsive, the heroin is so sedative that their impulsivity is kind of delayed by that.
It's an interesting point, isn't it? Yeah, that might... possibly might relate to that. We think there's a different endophenotype for heroin, which is more probably to do with anxiety than to do with impulsivity. Well, that's an interesting suggestion. So the other interesting thing about these rats, again, if you measure this before they ever see cocaine, they have reduced D2 receptors, D2, D3 receptors, I should say, measured with phalloprid ligand in the ventral stratum, that's here, rather than in the dorsal stratum. And this reduction correlates with the degree of impulsivity. So they have reduced D2 receptors before they ever see cocaine. So this phenotype suggests that low D2 receptors may predispose to binge cocaine taking. Okay. Now, there's quite a lot of work that's gone on subsequent to this, which I'm not going to have time to go into, but I'll refer to it briefly. And this is replicable effect. We've found it more recently in papers in Journal of Neuroscience. The interesting thing is that it seems that the self-administration of the drug upregulates the receptors in these high impulsive animals. It actually normalises their impulsivity. It's a bit like Ritalin in ADHD. Whereas in low impulsive rats, if you give self-administration of the drug, it down-regulates the receptors. So there are baseline differences in these D2 receptors, which are very plastic and are affected by the drug self-administration. Okay, so this is an autoradiographic analysis of Bianca Jarp with Jeff Daly of dopamine receptors in high and low impulsives. The D2, D3 ligands here, this is the dopamine transporter, this is the D1 receptor. And basically, the PET doesn't enable us to see where the changes in D2, D3 receptors are. Are they in the core or the shell? It's an important question. It looks like the D2 receptor changes, D2, D3 receptor changes, are in the shell. So here's the low impulses and here's the high impulses. This is quite a highly significant difference, in fact. Whereas in the core, there's no significant difference, or in the dorsal stratum. Intriguingly, the DAT, the dopamine transporter, is also downregulated in the high impulses, as you see here, particularly on one side of the brain, actually, as it happens, but the dopamine transporter is downregulated. So this is very interesting, and we're still trying to figure out, we need to figure out, exactly what the dopamine dynamics are in the shell here. So one issue is, why are the D2, D3 receptors downregulated there? Are they pre- or postsynaptic? We're not sure. Could be D3 receptors. Have they been downregulated because of changes in dopamine? We're not sure. But as a consequence of the downregulation of the dopamine transporter, there'll certainly be more dopamine sloshing around in the shell. And if these receptors are presynaptic, this means that the whole system is dysregulated and probably reflects increased dopamine overflow in the shell. This is our hypothesis, which we need to test. In the core, there's not much going on, apart from something we don't understand. The D1 receptor shows some small changes. But I'll come back to the core in a moment, because as you've already heard, the core is implicated in impulsivity, and it combines with the shell in producing this behaviour. So it's evidence, again, which supports the PET ligand evidence, in a sense, showing with nifedipine, the D3 receptor antagonist, again, this opponent effect in the core and the shell when infused into these regions. So in the shell region, the nifedipine increases impulsivity, as you'd predict, with reduction of D2, D3 receptors. So that goes the right way. And in the core, if anything, it's in the opposite direction. So this is pharmacological evidence which kind of supports the effect largely being in the shell region. And there's another technique that Jeff Daly and Caprioli have recently used, involving voxel-based morphometry and MR in the rat, looking at these high impulses, trying to see whether a change is structurally in brain which can be linked to the impulsivity. And one of the striking changes is in the core region of the accumbens, where particularly on the left side, but it's also on the right side, quite an amazing relationship between the degree of impulsivity in individual rats and the GM score, the neuronal marker score, the activity of the core, if you like, using MR. So in other words, the reduction of core structure is reflected in this increase in impulsivity quite dramatically. It's a huge correlation here. Of course, this implicates other, you know, neuronal activity in the core, and the obvious place to look at the medium spiny neurons, which of course are GABAergic. And if you look at a marker for these, GAD, GABA decarboxylase, you can see there's a reduction in the high impulsive rats in the core, particularly on the left-hand side. And additionally, if one uses antisense to GAD in the core, you produce increased impulsivity in low impulsive rats. So it looks like there's some change in the core as well in these high impulsive rats, which is analogous to a lesion, some obviously rewiring of the core, which in parallel with the shell is producing this impulsivity. So one way of explaining this, I'll come back to you in a sec. One interesting suggestion, given the opponency of these structures, is that the increased dopamine in the shell is producing a drive to this behaviour, which is normally gated by opponent influences of the core. But in these high impulsive rats, these are weakened, and so the impulsivity is expressed. This is obviously a speculative but testable idea. Yeah.
With the reduction in has anyone tried to virally rescue that rescue the expression of receptors and see if that then decreases impulsivity in previously impulsive rats?
I don't think that's been tried yet, but that's, you know, that would be an interesting approach, certainly. Yeah. And it'd also be interesting, I know there's interest here in the GABA receptor subunits. It would be incredibly interesting to look at relationships there in these in mice, actually, because there are similar effects in mice, but that can be related to the GABA subunits in the shell as well, potentially. Okay, so we're beginning to get some kind of idea. So we're beginning to get a pretty good idea about the neural network that's involved in controlling this impulsive behaviour. We've described some kind of relationship between the coral and the shell. We've identified an influence of the infralimbic cortex. It'd be interesting to know whether this is mediated directly via the shell or indirectly via downstream projections, for example, of the dopamine neurons. That's an interesting issue. We know the anterior cingulate's implicated in this behaviour, and we know that there are bottom-up mechanisms, notably from the serotonin neurons in the raphe. If we influence serotonin activity in the core, we get predictable effects on impulsivity. And also the locus coeruleus and the subcoeruleus, noradrenergic projections which project into the shell region. All of these play some role in modulating this impulsive behaviour. But this network has to be worked out in much more detail, and with the new tools that people like Christian and others are using. So I'm going to contrast this form of impulsivity, this waiting impulsivity, with another form of impulsivity later in the talk. But what I should also point out is that if one measures discounting behaviour in rats, this choice between small immediate rewards and large delayed rewards, we've known since we published a paper several years ago that damage to the core region greatly increases the rat's choice of the small immediate rewards. So the core is very much implicated in discounting. So it's implicated in these two forms of impulsivity, the premature responding and the choice impulsivity. And moreover, our high impulsive rats, the premature rats, also discount very steeply. They prefer small immediate rewards. So this construct of impulsivity makes sense at the level of the nucleus accumbens, particularly the core region, in mediating these two aspects. Okay, well, I'm just going to wind up before we take coffee with a few additional interesting results, I think, for this. How do you treat this impulsivity? Well, I've already mentioned that we observed that when rats are self-administering cocaine, these high impulsive rats, when we continue to test them for their impulsivity, it seems to get weaker. It's like ADHD. And we know that that's correlated with an upregulation of D2 receptors in the accumbens. But there are other drugs that also work. And one of the drugs that works is atomoxetine. Have you heard of atomoxetine? Atomoxetine is also called Stratera, and it's a treatment that's often used in ADHD because it's an atypical stimulant drug. It mainly blocks the reuptake of noradrenaline rather than dopamine. So it's often preferred by clinicians because it doesn't have any of the stigma associated with Ritalin or amphetamine. And it also has fewer of the side effects of these drugs. Unfortunately, it turns out not to be such a good drug for ADHD, but it is effective in many patients. And what it's particularly effective on, we've found, in humans with ADHD and in rodents, is impulsivity. So if you give rats atomoxetine, this is just systemically, you can normalise their high impulsivity completely. At doses which are not sedative, they're still adequately attending to the visual stimuli which they have to detect. So this is quite a remarkable effect, yeah.
I'm a little bit confused. Atomoxetine is serotonin?
No, noradrenaline reuptake blocker. It blocks the noradrenaline transporter.
Yeah. From this result, it controls impulsivity.
Yeah.
So, okay.
Yeah. That's the result. That's the result. It controls impulsivity. Okay? And intriguingly, if you infuse it into the shell region, which is in receipt of this projection from subcerebral noradrenaline cells, you get the same effect. whereas if you put it into the frontal cortex, you don't. So this effect of atomoxetine depends very much on this rather specific projection of the noradrenergic cells to the shell region. So I think it's very interesting that in the basal ganglia, there's relatively sparse noradrenergic innervation. But most of it is to the shell. And most of it's from the subcerebral projection. There's relatively little noradrenaline to be found in the dorsal stratum. In the shell region, you get this quite remarkable amelioration of impulsivity, which is interesting and maybe has clinical implications, because if you give atomoxetine in the seeking schedule, you get a similar effect to what we showed you earlier with the mu-opioid antagonist, a reduction of drug seeking. Once the drug's on board, it has no effect, but it does reduce drug seeking. And this isn't a sedative effect because they work for food on a standard schedule. It also works for heroin. This is a heroin self-administration on a similar schedule. Atomoxetine reduces drug seeking. So this has encouraged us recently to do a trial supported by the MRC in the UK to look at atomoxetine as a possible treatment for treatment-seeking stimulant abusers. We're currently doing that study. Okay, so the relevance to human addiction, I think I've shown you so far. The suggestion is that impulsivity may be what we call an endophenotype, a predictor of a risk for stimulant addiction. But let's have actually look at some human abusers. So this is a typical study we have with 10 cocaine and 8 amphetamine abusers, matched IQ, years of education. The abusers are generally more depressed, but they're not clinically depressed generally. And they've often been taking the drug for 10 to 12 years. So these are chronic stimulant abusers which fulfill the criteria for stimulant dependence, but not for any other substance except for nicotine and for cannabis, just two of them. So when you give this type of group the Barrett Impulsivity Scale, this is Ernst Barrett, who invented this scale. So a lot of questions which you're supposed to reflect on and give your answer to determine whether you're impulsive. So these are the kind of things that he asks. I plan for the future. I do things without thinking. That's obviously an impulsive thing. I don't pay attention. I'm self-controlled. I plan for job security. It's trick questions because you don't answer yes to all of them, right? You have to really attend to these. I say things without thinking. I blurt out the answer. Oh, I shouldn't have said that impulsively. I change jobs. I easily get bored. I'm restless at lectures. Notice complete attention. Thank you. Well, it's an interesting, it's a typical clinical scale. You know, it's quite sensitive, but there's a whole lot of stuff in there. It's not very precise, but it kind of gathers up what we mean by impulsivity. And if you give it to drug users, you'll get huge increases in their score compared to controls, as I was saying earlier. But in this study, this is a Karen Ursher's study, we also gave it to their non-drug abusing siblings, and they showed the intermediate phenotype. So the non-drug abusing siblings who don't take drugs, do not have a DSM-4 diagnosis, are also impulsive. Okay? Which suggests that it's in the family, in some sense. Interestingly, for sensation seeking, I'm going to come back to this, sensation seeking is, you know, take risks like climbing mountains and enjoying hang gliding and gambling and stuff. It's not so obvious. It's sensation seeking is clearly there in the drug users, but this is not present in the siblings. And I may come back to this because I think it's an interesting difference. Okay, so again, just winding up this part of the lecture, we have actually used the serial reaction time task to humans in recent studies, where it's very similar, really. You hold down this space bar until you see the target, and then you release it and touch the target. It's very similar in the rat. And premature responding is simply letting go of the button. You know, you let go of the space bar in order to respond. So if you let go prematurely, that's a premature response. And here's some data. So stimulant abusers, hugely premature responses. This is recreational cannabis users, they also show this. These are healthy volunteers. So at least this shows proof of principle that this task we used in rats can be used in humans to show increased premature responding in drug abusers. Now, we haven't used this yet in the siblings. What we have used is another very sensitive test of impulsivity called the stop task. Now, in this task, what happens is you have to respond as quickly as possible to the right or to the left in response to the computer-generated arrow. So these are coming up very quickly on the screen, one after another. You have to press right, left, right, right, right. But occasionally, 25% of the trials, a beep sounds, and that beep says you mustn't respond. So this is like the teacher saying, stop it. You mustn't respond. So you have to cancel the response. But the annoying thing about the beep is that it comes a bit unpredictably. So you can just be pressing the button and then the beep comes and you have to freeze and inhibit that response. So it's a very stringent test of motor inhibition, of cancelling an initiated response. Okay? And you can measure it very precisely, the stop task, using the stop signal reaction time measure. So this is the composition of a typical trial. So this is the stimulus, you have to go. There's a stop signal delay. So a delay period, this is jittered, so it's a bit variable when the stop signal comes. It could come very soon here after the go signal, or it could be delayed. Because the longer it's delayed, the harder it is to inhibit, right? Do you understand that? Yes?
So, particularly with psychostimulants, is there any evidence for motor control pathology for these sorts of tasks where...
Yes, I'm going to show you that. I'm going to show you. Well anticipated, but not premature. Okay, so what you have to hypothesise, someone called Gordon Logan invented this task and had the very clever idea that this is like a race. So the race model is much used in decision making cognition. It's a race between going and stopping. And his idea is that you can actually measure that race between going and stopping by looking at the response time distribution. So if, for example, you hypothesize that the stop signal reaction time comes at the exact point where the stop is balanced with the go, you've just won. The stop has just won over the go at the 50% point here. So you take that response time as your measure of the stop reaction time, the time when going and stopping are exactly balanced. Okay? It's very clever. And you add to it the stop signal delay, whatever that is, that's variable. You take that into account, I should say, in order to obtain the stop signal reaction time. And the kind of measures you get at this, they're very, maybe 200 milliseconds in ADHD individuals, but even faster in control. So you see a big difference in ADHD, for example, here, and you get a similar difference in stimulant abusers, as we'll show you. Here's the effect of Ritalin, interestingly. Ritalin completely ameliorates this in the lab in ADHD patients, as we'd predict, that these drugs seem to remediate impulsivity. Now, you can do this in rats as well. Dawn Eagle's done this. So you have the rat respond on one lever and then on the second lever very quickly. And if it does so within a certain amount of time, it earns itself a food pellet. But if a tone occurs following the first press, before the second press, the rat has to cancel that response and go directly to collect the food pellet. So again, you can measure a stop signal reaction time in the rodent. And using that, we've actually looked at the effects of D1 and D2 receptor antagonists infused into the dorsal stratum and the accumbens. They don't affect anything in the accumbens, which is very interesting, which shows probably this behaviour is more dorsal stratal dependent. But in the dorsal stratum, they seem to have opposite effects. So the D2 receptor antagonist actually impairs the stop signal reaction time infused into this dorsal medial area, not into the core. Whereas the D1 antagonist, if anything, seems to improve stop signal reaction time, which is interesting because of various debates about whether the direct and indirect pathways are in opposition in controlling output. This is some evidence, maybe, that sometimes they are in opposition. So I think this is quite interesting. But it does highlight the fact that this is a different set of circuits, a very parallel set of circuits. And I'm not going to go into all the detail here, but this is much more dependent on dorsal stratum, as well as on, as you'll hear, frontal structures, evidence both from rats and humans. So why this is relevant to addiction is as follows. If you study the neurology of the stop signal reaction time, we know that it's very much tied to damage to this inferior frontal region. It's area 45, 47. On the right-hand side, probably more than the left-hand side. So if you take brain damaged patients who have damage all over the frontal cortex and quantify the volume of damage in different sectors of the frontal lobe, you find that the area which is most correlated with the stop task is this right inferior frontal gyrus. That was shown a long time ago, and that's held up. Interestingly, if you do the Karen-Ursher experiment of comparing controls, stimulant-dependent individuals, your question, their siblings, and recreational stimulant abusers. So we all know what these are. Recreational abusers, people who take quite a lot of cocaine, often at the weekends. They're often quite affluent. They often work in the city in London, and they've regulated their drug use somehow. They're not, in any sense, DSM-4 abusers. So they're a very good control group. And they show excellent response inhibition, as you can see, the recreational drug users. But the dependent ones show terrible inhibition, and so do their siblings. Their siblings are almost as bad as the drug users. So this is an endophenotype. And what Karen-Ursher found is that using a measure of diffusion tensor imaging, essentially, to look at fibres rather than actual grey matter per se, she showed that there's a very nice correlation, and this is a huge number of points, with the degree of fractional anisotropy of the arcuate fasciculus innervating the frontal lobes here. And this is present both in the siblings and in the drug-dependent users. So there's just a hint, a suggestion here that this pathway may be impaired even in the siblings, in the families, associated with their deficit, as well as in the chronic stimulant abusers. So it may possibly be an endophenotype. There are huge ends in these groups, as you can see. And it's not simply dependent on cocaine per se, because the recreational users don't show it. It's related to addicts, stimulant addicts. Okay, another way of looking at this is longitudinally. So this is a study masterminded by Gunter Schumann, Institute of Psychiatry, where we looked at 2,000 14-year-olds recruited from mainstream schools and gave them all these assessments, neuropsychology, whole genome analysis, brain structure, and we gave them some brain imaging tests, including the stop signal reaction time task. Okay? And the idea here was to see whether we could predict vulnerability to ADHD, but also to drug abuse. Now, this study is subsequently going to be replicated at great expense in the US, going from 10 years old and longitudinally. It's going to be a fantastic study. It's called the ABCD study. But this study certainly showed some interesting results, I think, which are relevant to this issue. So these are obviously sections, horizontal sections of the human brain. What we've done here is cluster analyze the networks which underlie impulse control. So this is an interim analysis before we did the 2000 in total, but the 2000 showed the same result, essentially. With so many subjects, you can do what's called a principal component analysis and work out what activities are independent of one another in networks. During a successful trial and a failed trial. So there are going to be trials in the stop task where you successfully stop and the brain's going to be active then. And there's going to be trials where you, oops, I didn't stop. So that's going to be an interesting comparison. And by using principal component analysis, you can generate these eigenvectors which are associated with clusters of activity which are independent of one another but contribute, in this case, to stop signal success. And there are seven clusters that are identified here. Some of them are on the lateral orbital cortex. There's also medial frontal cortex. This large cluster here, which includes the anterior cingulate and the right inferior frontal cortex here, the basal ganglia, subthalamic nucleus maybe, presupplementary motor area and parietal regions, also important. And what was found when one correlated the reported drug use with the activity in these clusters is that adolescents, these are 14-year-olds, reporting drug use, generally alcohol or nicotine or both, had reduced activity in the lateral OFC here, which is quite interesting. Now, it's very unlikely that the drugs had caused this change because many of these kids had only just started taking the drugs. So we're assuming that they may have been there before. And of course, the ABCD study starting at 10 years old may help to confirm that. Now, the other interesting result was that adolescents reporting illicit drug use as well. By illicit drug use, I mean cannabis, stimulants, and I'm afraid to say heroin in this 2000 adolescent sample all over Europe. Very few heroin. But they showed, intriguingly, increased activity in this pathway, in this cluster, this right inferior frontal cortex cluster, which we'd earlier identified to be very important for this response inhibition. So this is very intriguing. But we've seen something very similar in a subsequent functional study of actual stimulant-dependent users and their siblings, as well as controls. So now, focusing on this, in particular on this right inferior frontal area, what you can see in controls, these are a number of sections, there is activity in this area during the stop task, which is not present in the stimulant-dependent individuals. So once they get to the stage of stimulant dependence, they're very bad at this task and they don't properly activate the network. Okay, that's clear. But interestingly, their siblings are showing increased activity in this network, even though, you know, their performance is quite bad, which suggests to us that the siblings are trying to inhibit. And maybe this increased activity in the siblings is protecting them from addiction, from drug seeking. That's a notion. In other words, it's providing resilience, which explains why their impairments aren't translated into drug seeking and addiction, maybe. So this is very speculative, perhaps, but I think the data are really quite interesting. Right, that's the end of part one. Part two, I'm just going to introduce now, this is after coffee, the transition from goal-directed behaviour to habit-based compulsion in drug addiction. So far we've been talking about the prodrome and the initial stages. After coffee, we'll talk about this phase, which Chuck O'Brien brilliantly has described in this quote. At some point after continued repetition of voluntary drug taking, which is what we've been studying so far, the drug user loses the voluntary ability to control its use. At that point, the drug misuser becomes drug addicted, and there is a compulsive, often overwhelming involuntary aspect to continuing drug use and to relapse after a period of abstinence. That's what we're going to discuss next. The switch from drug use to addiction. Thank you.